time. But again, as Mr. Wilson indicated, the 256 units are located in that area there with the standalone clubhouse. You can see the area as being protected under the prior plan. Craig, you can put up the proposed site plan, please.
And that's part of the packet?
That is.
Let the board know what page it's at.
And this is the residential portion. Again, we have the retail portion on joint page. This is the plan titled Proposed Site Geometry Plan, and it's dated April 28, 2022. As indicated, we removed the building, the two-story building that used to be located on the northern side of Laurel Boulevard, and we've expanded the detention basin that's located primarily in the eastern corner here, and expanded that to the entire lot. We concentrated the residential development to the southern portion of the lot. This consists of 30-unit buildings located in the rear, and then what we've done is on this building here, which is a 24-unit building, we've included the clubhouse and the amenities within that building itself. So the 8,000 square foot clubhouse and amenity area is located on the first floor of this building here. The outdoor pool, the cabana, the top lot, all the things that were previously approved, were just simply relocated into this building itself. We have a centrally located compactor here. Part of that centrally located compactor is there is a compactor for regular garbage, and there's also a compactor for recycling, which does handle all the recycling, and then the hauler who picks it up takes it back, and he takes it back to his sortation, and he provides the cardboard, glass, and the plastic for that. But that's how the garbage is handled for the residential component itself. One of the things that came up through our discussions with the township was the need for the extension of Railroad Avenue. As some of the board members may recall that were here, there was a plan for the developer to construct Railroad Avenue from Laurel Boulevard southerly to the end of our property line. We agreed to reinstate that, and we're going to build that portion of Railroad Avenue. There's a separate set of plans that are submitted to the township for just what we call the Railroad Avenue improvement plans. There was one comment in there which I will need some direction from the board's professionals. We get the fire letter, and that was about emergency access off of Railroad Avenue. It's my understanding in talking with the township that there may or may not have been ordinance passed about connections, driveway connections directly to Railroad Avenue. Obviously, this is emergency access. I'm not sure if we need relief if we provide that emergency access, but again, I just want to get some direction from the board so that if we do need relief, our plan can put on proper testimony for that.
The Railroad Avenue, that's just the end of your problem.
That's correct.
No further.
Was there ever any representations on prior applications that you were going to go farther south than that? Do you remember?
I don't recall that. I'm pretty confident the prior plan stopped at our property line.
I have a question. Originally, the town got the permit for Railroad Avenue, which went from the, really South Street all the way through to Lacey Road. And I know that the permit of the CAP has expired. Since you're going to be putting your application in a separate application, would you be willing to work with the township and put the township's section of the roadway, in other words, from the end of your property out to Haines Street, on the same permit as well as the bike path, because the bike path has to be on everything at the same time. Bike path, the county's going to put in, or you know, we piggyback with you and pay your company to do it. I think that would work out well. And if the town had that option available to them as well, it would save the taxpayers a lot of money if the town chooses to take and improve from your property over to Haines Street, because they're trying to create alternate roadways. And I think if you were willing to do that, it would go a long way to help out the town in being able to achieve what they want to achieve without having to go back and pay for all of it themselves on a separate.
Sure, so just so I make sure I'm clear of what we're potentially agreeing to is the township would be the applicant on the CAPR application. We would pay for the fees and any professional fees that the township
and the engineering
would need to
line.
Use,
yeah.
The engineer the road and everything. And then at some point in the future, if the township decides to build the road, we would be able to build it
Yeah.
So we do it at our cost, cheaper, to get reimbursed.
Exactly, when you're building your section, if the town, at that point in time, decides they wanna build theirs at the same time, they would have the option to have you build it at your cost, and even at the county, if we were to, the county wants to get that approved, so we can finish out the bike path. If the county was to do it, we did that with the town, when the first one was built, we paid the town to build the bike path out of county funds. So it would just be a lot cleaner rather than have a two capital, it's going through the process at the same time.
Sure, I would agree to that, the only question I have is, if it may be to Mr. Brady, is should the board act favorably on this application, if that's a condition, or if that's something that has to be done separately, as a development agreement, just so I know.
It'd probably be a condition subject to you working out the development agreement, I would show. Attorney, that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a hard one to answer, because you'll find, you've been before on this application, many a times, a couple times. The one thing, I apologize upfront, because this one's gone on for so many years, we've gotten a little seasoned now, and we've learned a lot over the last couple of years with these other developments that have been going in, so you might find some stuff redundant, or, you know, we may have some other conditions we want in there because of what we've been learning as time has gone past, and these other ones have come before us. Here's, now it's coming again, we may have some concerns that have popped up through other applications that we see are not beneficial to the town.
Or may not.
Or may not, it could go either way.
If I might, Mr. Chair, I heard with Mr. Alba, we told him every afternoon, and obviously it's a good thing for the town, and pleased to hear that he's.
Can you speak into the microphone, please?
I'm pleased to hear that he agreed to those things, of course, beyond my pay grade, but I'm pleased to see that he did it. My concern is the attorney for the entity, I thought I heard Mr. Brady indicate that we make a condition of the developer's agreement or something like that, as part of any approval, as part of the appropriate grant. My concern is when you get the resolution compliance, and somebody's gonna say, well, wait a minute, you haven't figured that out yet, and therefore you can't start building. So I wanna make sure that it's not a condition of building permit, it's a resolution compliance, that we can do it, and perhaps it could be something that's done, you know, in terms of the phase and timing, and if and when you ever do it. So I don't wanna be in a situation where we're catch 22, so that we can't start, because you haven't done something, you haven't done something, so we can't start. So I just wanna make sure that Mr. Alba's agreement to assist the town at our expense to do those things doesn't come back and bite us and say, well, you have to wait. So I wanna be able to start.
I think what we did the last time, when this came before the board was, because we talked about building that road, half of the units could be occupied prior to that road having to be built. But the capital permit would have to be.
Yeah, I don't know what the numbers are or can be. I don't wanna be in a situation where we're stopped and wait because the town hasn't decided yet whether they wanna do it or not. Because the town still has to agree to pay, as I understood the understanding. Sorry about that. But I don't wanna be in a situation where the town says, you know what? We're not sure what we're gonna do yet. And then all of a sudden we lose a month, 2 months, a year. So as long as it's clear to everybody that our agreement to do that is dependent on our getting COs and building permits, as a lawyer, I'm fine with whatever the town wants to give, get from us, whatever we're willing to give. I just don't want it to come back and bite us.
I can understand what you're saying. There's some things, if we make things conditions, like we were just talking, like we've got a lot of this application going before us tonight. If we broke conditions in there, I would think that would be the appropriate time to make a decision on what would be allowed and not be allowed.
But it goes to what we're agreeing to. I couldn't allow our applicant, my client, to agree to an open-ended situation. Because conditions have to be satisfied.
That's exactly what you're asking the board to do.
I say it again, sorry.
That's precisely what you're asking the board to do. Is Nick saying, well, I mean, what I wanna know from you is if the approval goes through, and then later on the applicant says, you know, gee whiz, we just don't feel like doing it anymore.
I know, you could have approved.
How do I enforce it? You tell me how I enforce it.
Well, it's in the developer's agreement.
But you're telling me we're not gonna have a developer agreement.
Oh, no, then it was completely unclear, I apologize for that. The developer's agreement certainly can say what we're obligated to do, if and when you opt to do it. All I wanna make sure is that it's not a condition of resolution compliance.
The agreement will be a condition of the resolution, but not after the build out.
And the agreement will provide that we'll do it whenever you decide it's ready. Because it's up to the town to decide to go.
That was the confusion I had. I want to make sure.
Well, that's my fault.
The agreement, yes, the agreement would be a condition before we build, before we get our CEOs or building permits or whatever, or going through resolution compliance, there'll be an agreement so that in the event the applicant changes their mind, what have you, we have something to enforce.
You and I now, at least I now, are on the same page. I appreciate the clarification.
Just to clear for the record, because you were talking about the fire company requesting the road in there. I thought the agreement for that road was built, that there was no curb cuts with the exception of St. Pius.
The original CAFR permit that was granted by CAFR was no permits for, no access in and out other than St. Pius as well as Fulton River School. Fulton River School has the ability to run a road into their school to trip, which was the intention really to get the buses out on the road. I think that's something the applicants do when he puts in his applications, to have to deal with at the CAFR level. If it's an emergency access only, generally they have you put away breakaway fencing, you know, and then you end up driving.
Should be broken away.
Yeah, you drive through with the firehouse and visit their fire truck, there's everything.
Can I point out something with regard to, it depends on where that access is, because if you put it on the southerly side of the property, that's where that big riprap apron is, and you wouldn't be putting an access way across that.
The only thing I would recommend is if you guys consider that, is that the west corner of what is Laura Boulevard, not Camelot Court, when you come in to make a right turn, but then you're taking away your drainage and water and then you're going to interfere with parking lots, so you're going to have to reconfigure parking because you're going to lose parking spaces.
I understand, Bruce. I'm not sure I understand what you're talking about.
We're talking about taking Laura Boulevard up and it'd be the north south right there, north south corner, and left there. If you came in with a brook
here,
you had access for the fire pumps coming off there, but it's going to change.
It's too close to the intersection for safety.
And plus we have the access point here off of Laura Boulevard. I think the whole point.
I don't see fire trucks coming down here. I really don't.
I don't see it either.
It's in that 2 mile of a road.
Again, it's a comment in the fire letter that we have to address somehow. Either we will agree to do as we can or the board wants us not to address it. It's really the board's purview as to what direction we want to go. I'm willing to put the access in, providing the capital to improve it. I'm sure the board has teach at the location, but again, if the town is concerned about it, doesn't want it, I'm okay with that too. We can certainly address that once we get to that letter.
I mean, Jim, I think the more important thing is to have the road built to give movement of traffic as opposed to fire trucks.
Three of us never saw the fire letter. I had no idea any of the comments. I had the letter from the fire department on the previous application.
Yeah.
But I had no idea.
I don't have it.
We have it either.
I don't have it. Okay, it says request that the railroad avenue be improved and extended from Railroad Boulevard south to the southernmost corner of the property. We'll go to 85 for the swing gate secured with a chain and lock for additional emergency access. That's at the southernmost corner, and that's where all the large drainage. That's the emergency spillway for the basin.
That's just that west corner.
Yeah.
Guys, and just speaking for me up here, I'm about there. We can't hear you, everything you're saying, so it's important that you speak up.
Just for clarification, and Bruce, maybe I don't know, again, I'm looking at the same way you did. The prior application had a driveway into our site located almost at the very southern end of our site. But it also had Railroad Avenue dead ending at the southern portion of Railroad Avenue. Are they talking about into our site or a breakaway chain here to access the future Railroad Avenue? I think they're talking about coming into our site, is what I believe, because why would they want it? If the other portion of Railroad Avenue is never built, there'd be no reason for a breakaway chain for them to go continue south on Railroad Avenue. I assume they're talking about where this driveway, because he says that's previously proposed or approved, is the driveway connection here, which is what we thought it was going to be. But again, defer to the board if you don't think it's something, and again, it's not something we couldn't add at a later date. It's not something I have to be committed to today. If it's something that, as we move forward through our CAFRA application, as Mr. Quinn indicated, it's been included in there, and if they approve it, we can build it or we can not build it. Again, it's just a, you know, emergency access that we can provide. And to one gentleman's comments about the breakaway chain, we've done them where they're actually gates, they're not breakaway chains, and they're actually sensored to the squelch of the siren when they open up. They don't have a key, you don't have to get out, you have to drive through the plastic clock. They're actually programmed to go off when the squelch of the siren goes off, the gates open up for emergency access, so police, ambulance, and fire can access it without actually getting out of the vehicle and having a knock box or drive through the proverbial plastic chain. And so that's something that can prevent that concern that somebody's going to break away and it's going to become an access. But again, I defer to the board as to what their pleasure is as we move further through tonight.
I would think, I mean, we brought it up early about Railroad Avenue, and of course we've got that portion that also has to be from your property out to Main Street. And like Jimmy brought up the emergency vehicles and stuff like that. There's no doubt that if we know that we're sort of be able to go in that direction with the continuation of Railroad Avenue, that could help clear up a lot of these issues we're having with exits, entrances, and the emergency vehicle, because now we got multiple entrance points with sizable curb openings where without Railroad Avenue, we don't have that. We're actually running into a dead end, turn around, swing around type situation. But if we get that from where it is now, on Little Boulevard corner up to Hain Street, I think that's going to help with a lot of the questions that's going to come before us tonight.
Yeah. And again, if it's something that you think, you know, a couple of gentlemen said they don't see a fire truck going down there because of the narrow. If it's something that you say, well, if and when the other portion of the railroad from our site to Haines goes through, we can address the emergency access. At that point, if it's something that you think would be more used, when it's not dead end anymore, so it's a through street, but they might be using it as a bypass to get off Route 9.
And the other reason why I just made that comment is because it will come up multiple times.
Yes. So again, just briefly, just talking about the proposed application. Again, switch to the commercial portion of it. Again, I know we're on here for preliminary, but for all intents and purposes, the convenience store and the gas station is unchanged from what the board previously saw and approved. The retail component here, there were some slight changes in the left-hand corner or the southwest corner of the site. Again, that was due as part of our character application of the areas that we had to protect in the rear here, as part of that. As far as DOT, that comes out in a letter, this is being treated as a letter of no interest. We're in the process of obtaining that from NJDOT. Our NJDEP CAFRA application, we expect to have in the next 30 days. They've agreed to lift the deed restriction already. I know it came up with Mr. Jacob's letter to cross this area here. They've already lifted that deed restriction. We're in the process now, but hopefully, according to the case manager, getting a permit within the next 30 to 45 days.
Along that line, if you were to provide access to Railroad Avenue, you'd have to go back to CAFRA and amend that deed restriction again, would you not?
That's correct.
Just so the board knows that aspect of that requirement.
Yeah, so to Mr. David's point, there's a deed restriction for landscape buffer area along the entire western side of the project. Under the prior approval, we were going to have to go to CAFRA to lift the deed restriction to cut through here. Obviously, that is not the case here, but in the event. And I'm not sure, to be honest with you, I can't answer you tonight, how the DEP looks at that if it's an emergency access versus a full driveway cut through conservation. They may look at it as you're clearing trees, no trees, it's emergency, as a full access driveway. We can deal with that, as Mr. Quinn indicated, as part of the CAFRA application for Railroad Avenue. I believe that summarizes most of the changes and why we're here tonight, and an overview of the project itself, and what we're intended to do.
Can we go through Bruce's letter? And you said that we haven't addressed the testimonies, indicate where we will comply, so that there's nothing left open in that letter.
He really starts from the bottom of the
Yeah, as Mr. Wilson indicated, this is a gravat, completeness and development review number one, amended preliminary final, dated April 2nd, revised July 19, 2022. If appropriate, Mr. Chairman, starting at the bottom of page four, on paragraph A, general comments. Number one, provide testimony of the variance and waivers. Obviously, our plan will be doing that a little bit later in our testimony. Again, Bruce, I think I touched on a lot of these items as we go through. I described the new layout under number two. I talked about the recreation components. Number four talks about the access behind buildings 8 and 9.
So you're saying you would read through the road?
These are just general comments, we'll look at the testimony. On number four, he's talking about access to the back of these buildings. Again, we went through this in a lot of detail. That's unchanged from the prior application. The concern is that there's a retaining wall that's about 9 feet behind the buildings. And it varies from, obviously, no retaining wall up to, I believe, 8 feet in the center. Again, he was concerned about it, and that's unchanged from the prior application as far as access back there. And again, we'll go through the fire letter in a few moments. Number five, talking about porous pavement. Again, that was a requirement under part of our CAFRA application. This porous pavement, anything shown on the plan for porous, will be only maintained by us in both the residential and the commercial development. And that's going to be a requirement, not only for the township, but as a DEP requirement. Longevity of porous pavement, again, it's our experience based on testimony of about 20 years. Shelf life on porous pavement, as long as it's maintained. Again, we have several sites that have porous pavement, so we're used to what it takes to maintain between vacuuming and cleaning of the porous pavement. Number seven, CAFRA. Again, we've kind of talked about three of our CAFRA application. Does require some additional conservation areas that I spoke about to change some of the components. If you remember, on the prior application, there was a clubhouse located in this area here. This entire green area here now, which is adjacent to the small stream over here, is now being preserved. And then more area behind the retail, again, it's adjacent to the wetland that's being preserved as part of the pending CAFRA application. Phasing, again, commercial development, we're only here for preliminary. Residential, we don't anticipate any phasing at this point. We just, again, depending on whatever happens with the development agreement and phasing, but for tonight's purposes, we can just build it. The trash and recyclable that I spoke about.
Can I follow up with the phasing?
Sure.
Is the phasing for application purposes or for construction purposes as well?
Both.
And
just for the record, there's affordable units are throughout the development itself. So as far as color phasing, obviously, as we're building the marketing units, the color phasing, the color units will be coming on as well. So there's several color units in each building. So there'll be one on when the marketing units are going on as well. Number ten, adequacy, obviously, trash compactor, the garbage areas come down to, frequency comes down to use. Typically, we're finding that residential projects of this magnitude, twice a week, normally, usually Monday mornings, because they're heavy garbage recycling for the weekends, and typically Monday during the week. Commercial, again, depends on tenants, but it's just a matter of frequency, it's not a matter of increasing the size of the area. If you find out that it's filling up too quickly, you just fill it three times a week, probably two times a week. And that's just something we oversee as part of our maintenance. Shopping cart storage, but again, Bruce, I'm not much detail, I'm gonna get into the retail on the back, but there is shopping cart storage adjacent to the building shown on this current plan. But again, that's subject to change once we get a tenant. The delivery trucks, again, except for small box trucks for move-ins, the residential delivery itself, that's all anticipated, and obviously provided the fire truck turning radiuses for the back that can handle truck turning movers in there. The commercial, it's really unknown at this point, we just provide truck turning, but again, we'll be back for final approval on that. Hours of operation, again, we'll be back for final approval on that, it's unchanged. Catholic and DOT I spoke about, Bradford Avenue I spoke about. And then, Mr. Chairman, if it's appropriate, this is where we get into the technical comments. I'll just go through which ones I could briefly comply with, and just touch on the ones that would need an answer or testimony. So under paragraph F, 1, 2, and 3, we agree to comply. 4, I spoke about the NJDP, they've already lifted the deed restriction. 5, 6, and 7, we agree to comply. Number 8, I have a question for Mr. Wilson and for Mr. Brady. Talks about improving the railroad on the South Street intersection. I don't have a question. We agree to comply. I thought this had to do with the parking of the building. It's not Railroad Avenue and South Street. We agree to comply. Sorry. 9 through 12, we agree to comply. Number 13 on top of page 7, Mr. Jacobs, again, I need some clarification on this because I couldn't figure out exactly what you're talking about. But again, as far as retail, I'm going to address it when we come back to final work. You could just explain to me now what you're talking about with the reducing the hatching size. I know the hatching that's on the southern side of the building here, but I'm assuming you mean by reducing this, you can increase the pedestrian on the side of the building, but that doesn't help to the front of the building. I just don't know if that's what you're referring to.
I have a sketch that's going from the south side going towards the bank.
Okay, so it's hatched area here. Decrease the size of that so you can widen the walkway.
I was looking at it just going through the the island.
Okay.
And that lines up with the sidewalk on the
front of the store.
In front of the bank.
Okay. We agree to comply with that. 14 through 19, we agree to comply. And number 20, again, it talks about the grades of the retail store. Again, I talked about the storage, but again, we'll be back for final on that. 21 through 28, we agree to comply. Under paragraph, under miscellaneous, 1 through 6, we agree to comply. And on the bottom of page 8, which carries over the division lines and outside agencies, we agree to comply for the applicable agencies for this project.